So the title is Asymptotic Distortions in Locally Misspecified Moment Inequality Models. Long title. And John work in progress with Ivan and I over there. And Patrick Berger, not here. And so I'm going to talk about moment inequality models, and it's going to be moment inequality and inequality models. And my first claim is that inference in partially identified moment models defined by moment inequalities and equalities has become recently popular in the literature. And they're so popular that we have now multiple methods in order to implement inference if we had a model that is characterized by moment inequalities and equalities. And I'm going to mention the methods in a second, but we want to have at least 6 or 7 methods to implement inference. So the beauty or the reason why I think they're popular is because partially identified models are going to allow us to be relatively agnostic regarding certain assumptions that we consider fundamental in economic theory. However, as in any inference problem, if we're going to make progress in the problem, we need to make certain assumptions that we might consider less fundamental. So this might be a little bit controversial, so let me be very clear on what I mean by fundamental and less fundamental. So I have 2 examples, which are actually the examples of the paper. First example is missing outcome data in a parametric model. So you're trying to estimate a model of y given x in a parametric model. And unfortunately, when you look at your data set, you're missing a couple of, or some of a fraction of the y's in your data set. Okay, so we know that we can, we would like to be agnostic about distribution of the unobserved data. Okay, so in particular, we would not like to assume that the distribution of the data that is unobserved is equal to the distribution that is observed. So we would like to avoid that assumption, and we would like to avoid any assumptions about the distribution of the unobserved data, and we consider that a very fundamental problem. But we have a less fundamental assumption. For example, we are courageous enough to be able to assume a parametric model for y given x. Okay, so we have a functional form that we're going to assume. Okay. The second, and I said less fundamental because basically economic theory might not give us a particular functional format we are going to assume. And edge again with multiplicity of equilibria, so this is essentially coming from a paper by Tamer where you're analyzing a situation where there are a few firms deciding whether to enter or not into a certain market, and it's easy to see that in these kind of models we might have multiplicity of equilibria. And there's nothing in the economic model that tells us how multiplicity of equilibria is resolved in these games. So we would like to avoid making assumptions about equilibrium selection. However, in order to make progress, we need to make assumptions about functional forms, so for example, the profit function or distribution of the errors in the profit function. So the motivation for this paper is this, that moment inequality models are nice because we are agnostic about certain objects, but they're still subject to misspecification because we still have to make certain assumptions about parametric function, distribution form, and so on. So if you review the literature on inference in partially identified models, in moment inequality models, you notice that we know very well how to compare different inferential methods when the models are correctly specified. Okay? We're not making any mistake in this specification. The question that we ask in this paper is, first, what are the properties of inferential methods when the models are subject to misspecification? It's going to be local misspecification, I'm going to explain in a second. And in the case of there's local misspecification, which method are we going to recommend? So there are going to be different methods, and some methods are going to, as we will see, perform better than others. So we're going to make recommendations, actually recommendations out of this paper. So misspecification can be anything, so in this paper we're going to consider local misspecification. I'm going to explain what that means right now. So this is how local misspecification is going to work. Okay, let me know by script F, this is going to be a little bit confusing. Script F is going to be the restrictions of the economic model. Okay? And let's for now think that there are 2 parameters, theta star and F star. So theta star is going to be a finite dimensional parameter, F star is going to be a distribution. So we're going to consider the parameter and the distribution as our parameter belonging to a certain model. Okay, so there's a true parameter, a true distribution that in principle satisfies the restrictions of the economic model. Okay, that would be a correctly specified model. okay, in a misspecification setting, okay, instead of observing data from theta star S star that belong to the model, we're going to be observing data from theta star Fn, where Fn is going to be a distribution that is going to be a perturbation of F star. Okay, in particular, theta star Fn are going to be coming from a perturbation of the model Fn. Okay, so the true model, when there's misspecification, is going to be script Fn. Okay, the econometrician is going to think that the true model is script F. Okay, and it's going to happen that the econometrician receives data from theta star Fn coming from the perturbation model and possibly violating the original hypothesized model. Okay, so up to here, I'm characterizing what I mean by misspecification, and now we're going to talk about local misspecification, a specific kind of specification. And the misspecification is going to be local in the sense that the distance, and I'm going to define what I mean by distance in a second, but the distance between the hypothesized model and the perturbation model are going to converge to zero as n goes to infinity. Okay? And something that I will claim now and I will explain later, and you should make sure that I explain this well, is that in the moment inequality models, so in principle, Fn, we need to converge to F, or we don't say what's the relationship. What I'm going to say is that in moment inequalities and inequalities model, the only perturbation that is going to make sense based on our consideration of examples is going to be that script Fn, which is going to be the perturbation, the true model, is going to be a superset of F. Meaning that if this is a model that the econometrician is hypothesizing, the perturbation, the true model, is going to be an expansion which is going to shrink into the hypothesized model. Okay, so the reason for this is going to be explained in a second through examples. For now, you have to trust. So, of course, we are considering local misspecification, so you might wonder, what is this representing? Well, it's just we consider this a local approximation, so it's basically an approximation to a situation where there is misspecification, but the misspecification is small. Okay, so it wouldn't be adequate for a big amount of misspecification, because by nature, the amount of distance between the hypothesized model and the true model is converging to zero, so we need to be relatively close. Okay, so for example, the typical example of this is you assume that the model is probit, okay, and the true model supposes logit, and we have already seen that at least around the median, these models are close to each other. So I would say that this is a pretty good assumption to analyze a situation where you have true probit and a hypothesized model being a logit. Okay, so how are we going to do hypothesis tests? Well, we're going to, as happens in reality, the researcher is not going to be aware of the misspecification. Okay? He's going to assume that the true model is scripted F, and he's going to apply blindly any of the available inferential methods, hypothesis tests that he has available. Okay, in particular, For any parameter value theta naught, which is fixed in the parameter space, he's going to be interested in conducting the following hypothesis test. He wants to test where the true parameter is equal to theta naught or not. Okay, so this is the test he's interested in. How do we perform hypothesis test? Yes.
I'm sorry, I have one question. So why do we care about local specification rather than general
specification? Is it because when there is a large amount of misspecification, the data can tell you that the model is specified, so you don't care about that case?
Principle,
you could be very confused about the model. So we care about local misspecification because we have misspecification, and you can approach the problem in a local sense or in a global sense. The global problem is going to be a much harder problem to analyze, and there's, as far as I know, only one paper that does that in the local and the partially identified model, which I'm going to mention. And the results are limited to a certain class of models. Our analysis is going to be local. It's going to apply to a more general class of models, as you will see. It's basically we're going to take the framework that is out there, which everyone is using, of moment equals inequalities. And we're going to be able to say much more, but of course, you might say, well, it's local, but it's not a global problem. Whenever you have misspecification, my recommendation would be, if the misspecification is small, then this could be a very good approximation to that problem. If the problem that you have is really a large misspecification, classification problem, then this might not be an adequate frame.
Would it be helpful to think of this as a seed estimation problem?
So everything is not this parametric, and we're not. So one way, so I think you're thinking of us being non-parametric with respect to the problem. That, so suppose you have a distribution, and you want to be non-parametric with respect to the distribution, we're not going to. There's going to be an assumption about the parameter, and we're going to make the wrong assumption, and we're going to assume that the wrong assumption and the true model are going to be close in a certain sense. We're not.
You can do that through a sieve sort of lens, like sieve estimation essentially. Sure, it's non-parametric, but often it just means you have a sort of a fairly rich parametric model, and maybe as the sample size grows, you assume that it's rich enough to be close enough to the true model.
Yes, but
it looks like it's the same.
Right, but we're not going to analyze. So in seed estimation, you have to take into account that as you end of infinity, you have to enlarge the parameter space. Here, the researcher is completely naive about the misspecification. He's going to take the model with a misspecification as if it were true. So he's going to be wrong. He's going to get the result wrong. And what we're going to do, as I will explain in a second, is essentially compare tests as to how wrong they're going to be. Some tests are going to be more wrong than others, and we're going to be able to provide a ranking as to which test performs better in the light of investigation. All of them are going to be wrong. Some of them are going to be more wrong than others. And we're going to provide essentially the ranking.
You do have a sequence of events.
So you mean about the distribution of that. But in many of these models, for example, the entry games, that is not incrementally identifiable. So that you make an assumption on M and then you get something, or you make an assumption with nothing. That's why you cannot do it.
You still
don't
get something. You're just stopping.
Well, let's see.
Yeah, let me continue. Maybe I answer to the question. So how do you perform a test like this one? So traditional way, we're going to define a test statistic. And we're going to define a critical value associated to this test statistic, and we're going to reject or not, depending on whether the test statistic is greater than a critical value or not. Okay. So, what is the minimum condition that you request from any of these tests? Well, you're going to look at the asymptotic size of this test. Okay? And the minimum requirement that you ask for any of these tests is the asymptotic size to be no larger than alpha. Okay, so what is the asymptotic size? Here you have the probability of rejection, and what you want is that the supremum of so you're going to characterize the supremum of the probability of rejection or the class of models that you're looking at, and then you're going to take the limit as n goes to infinity. Okay, so we would love to work with finite samples. Unfortunately, that's not a possibility. So work with asymptotic size. Okay, so relative to what you've seen in other papers in moment inequality models, is essentially that the sequence of models here depends on n due to the misspecification. Okay, so in other papers you won't see this n because there's going to be a fixed model which is going to be the right model. We're going to have a sequence of wrong, so sequence of right models approaching to the hypothesized model. And the presentation will only talk about tests, but if you're interested in confidence tests, then by inversion, basically our paper also deals with this case, although I'm going to move it out for presentation purposes. Okay, so the asymptotic size is going to provide a measure to evaluate the robustness of a test procedure under local specification. Okay, so let me explain why. So you have the hypothesized model, and you have a sequence of true models that are going to be, as I said, as I promised to explain, an expansion of the hypothesized model. So if you look at the formula, you are computing supremum over a set, okay, and since these Fn are larger, what's going to happen is that the asymptotic size that you're going to get because of the misspecification is going to be larger than the asymptotic size under correct specification. Okay? So in particular, what's going to happen under local misspecification is that the actual asymptotic size is going to be larger than the hypothesis. It could happen that the asymptotic size is larger than the desired rejection probability, which is alpha, 5%. Okay, so we're going to have, because of this problem, a size distortion. Okay? So what we're going to use is asymptotic size distortion as a measure of robustness to local misspecification. So if you wanted 5%, because of intensification, some tests are gonna reject 10%, some tests are gonna reject 20%, some tests are gonna be rejecting 90%. We're gonna say that the one that distorts the least, the one that is closest to alpha, is gonna be the one that is more robust to local intensification.
So I think the thing that strikes me as odd is that you reverse the F and the Fn from the roles that they would play in sieve estimation, right? I mean, in the sieve literature, you have F being a true model, and then Fn is like a parametric approximation to a larger space, some sort of larger function space, whatever. Here you're letting the truth change with N, and you're fixing the model that you're applying. And instead of your model growing to the truth, you've got the truth shrinking to your model.
Yeah.
Perhaps you could just rewrite everything in the conventional way and everything would still work out exactly the same. I don't know.
Well, you can even have a situation where they're not related. I mean, you could have gone. I mean, and FN not included in F and still conversion class.
Yeah, so you. So this is for simplicity, but what's happening is this is the script F, and the true model, okay, could be script FN, where. So the true model could be a model where some of the conditions in F are violated, meaning that this set over here is not going to be a part of script Fn. That wouldn't change the results. Okay. And here I'm not going to use that, but you can have more weird setups. But essentially, the intuition that I'm going to give you is the one that comes out from Fn being larger than F. And the reason why Fn is not becoming larger than F is because something I'm going to explain later. The reason why I like this ordering of F being the model that is hypothesized is because the researcher is going to take the model that he believes and he's going to keep it fixed, and we're changing the reality. Okay? We will not assume that the researcher is shifting around his model. His model is fixed.
Well, you do that in the entire sieve literature.
Yeah, but he's not using sieve. He's not changing.
I don't see sieve as a technique as much as a framework for looking at this specification. Just a matter of how you look at it, I guess.
But
maybe that this is exactly the same, just sort of philosophical.
What was striking as different is we're not going to be non-parametric.
The C's aren't really non-parametric either. It's just a parametric.
They are. I think they are.
They can be, but in practice, usually
practice
it's
parametric.
Yeah.
No, you implement them parametrically, but it's a non-parametric method, right?
It's a philosophical question.
But it's still like it's similar to what we're doing. Is if you think about contamination data or this type of literature, sieves, you know exactly what you have to approximate, okay? But you cannot do it, and so you look for an approximation that is feasible to approximate that hard object you want to approximate.
Yeah.
Here, FN is not hard; something that you. We're looking at what people will do, who doesn't do in practice, okay? People have a fixed model.
Yeah, practice.
And we're saying the data can come from a model that is similar, okay? The only way that we want to do things locally, and going back to Barbara's question, because we want to keep the interpretation of the data. Otherwise, we'll have pseudo parameters and things like this that are not allowed to interpret. So do things locally, I keep the interpretation of data not. All right? So it's just a modeling. We're not saying anything deep at this point. We're just trying to content model how people do things and how things can be different in practice. You shouldn't push it farther than that.
But the fundamental assumption, though, is that F and Fn are close.
Yes.
And you could reverse the roles they play. And the fundamental assumption
would
be
yes.
Absolutely. Yeah, you choose to do the opposite way.
I think you're gonna see more clear why I chose this when I give you my example.
Okay.
You can tell him, man.
Okay. So as I said, the procedure is gonna be robust to local specification when this amount, which is gonna be positive for the test because there is some specification, is gonna be very useful. So one very important point here is that whatever I'm gonna say later on, you should be expecting some trade-off between robustness, what we're talking about in this paper, and power analysis. Okay? And then explain why. In robustness, you have a hypothesized model, which is wrong. Okay? And you are receiving non-hypotheses from the correctly specified model that look like the alternative hypothesis from the point of view of the researcher. So the researcher receives non-hypotheses. but they look like the alternative hypothesis. Okay? So he's going to have a tendency to reject them. Okay? So in local misspecification, we have a sequence of nulls that look like the alternative. And in order to be robust, you need to not over-reject. You need to control yourself and not over-reject. So you would like to reduce the rejection rate. When you're doing power analysis, meaning local alternative analysis, you have the essentially the reverse situation. You have a null hypothesis, and you're receiving information coming from the alternative hypothesis that is looking closer and closer to the null hypothesis. But when you're doing power analysis, the goal would be to reject these guys. Okay? So from this trade, so this trade-off is very concrete, and you might expect that all we're going to say is that whenever a test is more powerful, it's going to be more less robust, and whenever a test is more robust, it's going to be less powerful. Okay? And if that were the case, if I were to just say that in this paper, then I wouldn't be presenting this paper. So actually what I'm going to do is concentrate on situations where this trade-off does not manifest itself, at least in a strict way. Okay, so again, the conclusion of the paper is going to be to run the following hypothesis testing procedures in terms of the robustness. So in the moment equalities and inequalities, we have the following table, and you can have different choices for your test statistics, so remember the TN, and you have different choices for the way you're going to approximate the quantiles of the test statistics. You can use plug-in asymptotics, subsampling, and generalized moment selection. And test statistics you can use to modify metal moments and quasi-like integration. And you can choose whatever set you want over here. And our goal is going to be to rank in terms of robustness, this criterion, the alternatives in these boxes. Okay? And the points of the paper are going to be the following points. So in some cases, the trade-offs that I was already mentioning about power and robustness is not going to strictly manifest itself. Okay? And those are, I think, cases where we're going to think that the results are really interesting. When you're doing a comparison of the ranking of the columns, okay? So one thing is you might expect that the ranking of the columns in terms of ranking might depend on where you are in the row. Actually, they don't, and that's a finding that we consider interesting. Okay, so...
when was the last time you turned it off?
So should I turn it off?
Yeah.
See? Okay, so we have PA, subsampling, GMS, modified moment selection, modified moment and modified method moments, and quasi-like integration. And when we compare the columns, okay, what's going to happen is that PA, okay, out of these three methods, the one that's going to be more robust, the one that according to robustness is going to be more recommendable, is going to be that PA is going to be better than subsampling or GMS. And the interesting result is that subsampling and GMS are going to be equally good in terms of robustness. Okay, so that's comparing the rows. And when we compare the columns, we're going to observe that modified method moments is going to be more robust than quasi-like integration. Okay? And we're going to see that here the trade-off is not going to be respected, whereas here the trade-off is going to be respected, but we're going to have something to say very interesting in terms of not the comparison, but the numbers that you're going to obtain in terms of asymptotic size of this method versus this method.
So if I look at your statement two, where you say modified method moments is more robust than quasi-like the ratio, do you mean no matter what of the rows I use?
Yes.
Okay.
Which is, you mean no matter what, no matter what column?
Yeah, so if I guess when you say that inequality two, you're saying MMM, when you use plug-in asymptotics, that's more robust than plug-in QLR with plug-in asymptotics.
Yes.
And I'll do the same for subsampling.
Absolutely. Yes. And that's something that is, in principle, not obvious. So the ranking of the rows could depend on the columns and vice versa. And as I was saying, we are going to have this relationship, but quasi-like integration is going to be extremely non-robust. So we're going to recommend researchers to be careful with quasi-like integration when they're suspecting misspecification. Okay, so we're related to a literature basically proposing all these methods, and we're actually out of this literature, what I want to point out is Anderson Soares and Anderson Kia. And Anderson Soares are going to be, besides of proposing some of these methods, Anderson Soares are going to compare the methods, okay? I'm going to compare the columns in terms of power. Okay, so when I analyze the trade-off, I need to look at the results in Andrews and Soares in order to understand if there's a trade-off between power and roughness or not. And Andrews and Hia is a paper that is going to compare the rows in terms of power. So again, I'm going to look at that when I'm analyzing the trade-off. And there's a literature on global mistification and local mistification. Again, in terms of partially defined models, which is what we do, the only paper I'm aware of in terms of global is Polyvariant Tamer, and that's a particular setup. I think, so as far as I know, we're the only paper on partially identified local mistification, and we do this in a little bit more generality in terms of models.
So what's in the Klein and Santos? Something they had was on local mistification.
No, the mistification part was global, and it's related to the paper by Shonsuko and it's pretty much that even with the models misspecified, the quantum version has an interpretation in terms of many distance.
So this is a roadmap for the rest of the presentation. I'm going to set up the model, and I'm going to give you an example, and that's where I'm going to justify this expansion that I was drawing over here. I'm going to do some asymptotics on the local mistification, and then I'm going to go ahead to analyze the robustness, first comparing columns and then comparing rows, and then I'm going to conclude. So for each comparison, I'm going to produce a ranking and make recommendations. So let's go to the setup of the model. So we're going to build our setup in the framework in Anderson Soares. So it's a very general framework. So in their framework, the model script F is going to be the sequence, the set of parameters and distributions that satisfy this collection of conditions. You have a restriction on the parameter space, IID, variance, restrictions on variance, restrictions on correlation, restrictions on moments, and most importantly, two equations over here. Forget about dividing by the standard deviation, because that's just dividing by a positive number. You have, in terms of M, you have that the expectation of M, J, is going to be positive, so this is a sequence of P moment inequalities, and a sequence of K minus P moment equalities. Okay, so that's the model when you have correct specification. And you have to trust me here, but this is going to be our model. So in terms of the previous model, the difference is essentially that we allow for scripting with N, and where does N appear? It appears over here. So the moment inequalities that before were greater or equal than zero are now going to be greater or equal than some sequence, okay, which these are going to be positive numbers. So this is going to be a sequence that is going to be negative, and it's going to be converging to zero. And this is a sequence that is going to be positive, and it's going to be converging to zero. And the appropriate rates are n to the minus 1/2.
Why are those appropriate?
Yes, just next slide.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, so this is going to be strictly our model. So what I need to justify, so from here, it's relatively clear that the spaces of correctly specified models are going to be expansions of the incorrectly specified model, just because we are allowed moment inequalities, which are supposed to be positive or zero, greater than zero, are going to be greater than some negative number, so it's a little bit wider. And things that are equal to zero are going to be allowed to be less or equal than some positive number. So here you can see that really we're expanding the set of models. Okay? And why I do that, you have to wait for a couple of more slides. Also, you have to notice that as n goes to infinity, this number and this number are both converging to zero, meaning that we're converging to f. Okay, and that's what I mean by this. Okay, and so his question, n to the minus 1/2 is essentially the right rate to make the problem that we're considering relatively interesting, but manageable. Okay, so if you assume that this sequence is goes to zero faster than square root n, essentially the problem of mistification essentially is you can ignore it. Okay, it's going to be the problem of asymptotic of approximation, asymptotic approximation is going to be more important than the problem of intensification, which is going to disappear. And if you vanish any slower, then you're in Barbara's question where you're globally misspecified. So if n, so if you converge to zero and it's lower than n to minus 1/2, you have a misspecification that is more important than asymptotics, it overwhelms asymptotics, and we have to analyze it with global methods. Okay, so finally I'm going to use the example to illustrate the framework and justify these equations over here. Okay, so let's look at the parametric model with missing data. So we have a true economic model, for now it's true, where the expectation of y given x is equal to g. So it's a parametric function. And so theta star is the true parameter value, f star is the true data generating process. And unfortunately, you have missing observations. And let me indicate by w be turned on. So it's a binary value that is value 1 when y is observed, is equal to 0 if it's not. Just for simplicity, let me assume, so I'm going to use Mansky bounds, so I need logical bounds on y. Let me assume that y is something like wage, has a lower bound of 0 and no upper bound, in principle, theoretically. So lower bound is going to be equal to 0, upper bound is equal to infinity. So if you impose these logical upper and lower bounds on this problem with missing data, what you end up is with a sequence of j moment inequality. Okay, let's take this one. So the model is, aside from other restrictions, is a set of theta star and f star that satisfy this condition. Okay, so so then let's assume misspecification. Okay, so I'm going to assume that now that instead of observing data from the hypothesized model and from theta star f star, the econometrician is going to observe data from theta star fn. Okay, where expectation of fn is going to be equal to a function gn. Okay, so it's a shifting function, which is basically the true model. It's a shifting function. Okay, and the perturbation has to be local. Okay, in the sense that the distance between gn and the hypothesized model is conversion to zero at this rate. Okay, and why the rate? Because of what I said before. So. If you repeat my argument, the argument that I just gave you, with the missing data and this model, so if the combination were to observe this model, if you were to know the exact DGP, the model theta star fn will be characterized by all the thetas and f that satisfy this moment condition. It's exactly the same as before, except that now we're having the gn function. So then I ask myself, okay, the combination doesn't know the function gn. He knows, he's going to pretend that the true function is the function g. And he's going to use this kind of structure based on this kind of structure. So the question is, what can I say instead of zero when I combine this information, which is the true information, with the fact that gn and g differ by this amount? Okay, when you combine this piece of information and this piece of information, what you can say is that the true model restricts theta star and fn to be such that they satisfy this moment condition. Okay, so this over here is just coming from the combination of this and this. So it's, what can I say from this kind of structure about the g function, which is the hypothesized function, when the model is misspecified? And you get this kind of equation. So they look exactly like what we assume around here. Okay. So this is why we're considering expanding models, because all the examples that we consider essentially produce expanded models. Okay, so so the question is, what happens when you have asymptotic, what happens to asymptotic size when there's local misspecification? Under correct specification, your test should be constructed so the asymptotic size is less or equal than alpha. If your test is not conservative, you should be equal to alpha. So this is a desired property. What's going to happen is, because of this expansion, under local misspecification, you're going to have asymptotic size possibly larger than alpha. And this is coming from the intuition that I gave before. So the name of the game, in order to characterize this asymptotic size, is being able to compute these guys. In order to be able to compute these guys, what we have to characterize is which are the worst sequence of parameters theta naught Fn. So these are sequences such that when I compute probabilities with these sequences and I take limits, the limit of the probability that I'm using is equal to the limit sub which I'm looking for. So it's worse because it generates the highest value. So again, here you see an important difference with local and asymptotic analysis, local alternative analysis. In local alternative analysis, you don't choose the worst sequence. You just take any sequence that corresponds to the alternative hypothesis and you analyze it. Here, we are not content with any sequence. We need to find the sequence that is worse in the sense that it generates the asymptotic size because that's what we are after. Okay, we're going to consider the statistics of the form Tn equal to some function of sample average multiplied by square root n and sample variance. So this is coming from the framework in Anderson Suarez. And part of the choice of the test is going to choose the function s, which I'm going to mention later. And this is the lemma that characterizes what happens when you look at sequences. So this is what happens when you choose when you analyze asymptotics under any sequence, and our job is going to have to find the worst sequence. So under any sequence of parameters that belongs to the model, and the limit of these two parameters are h1 and omega, so these are just parameters, the distribution of the test statistic converges to this guy, okay, where the important feature, so this is a normal distribution, h1 is going to be important parameter here, which is going to characterize the amount of the amount of slackness on the moment conditions. So if you were correctly specified, the amount of slackness for the moment inequalities could be from 0 to infinity, and there's no slackness for the moment equalities. If you're under local specification, you are allowing for slackness in the moment equalities, so the moment inequalities, sorry, starting from a negative number, so minus r, and you're allowing also for some slackness on the moment equalities. So basically, when you're doing traditional analysis, here's where you're looking sequences. In our case, we're looking sequences that satisfy this kind of restrictions. So let me analyze the robustness of test statistics when I compare columns. Okay, so for the rest of this subsection of the talk, I'm going to fix the test statistic in whatever value you want. And I'm going to compare the columns, and I'm going to see which one provides more robustness. Okay, so as I said, we're going to compare the three main choices of ways of approximating critical values, varying asymptotics, subsampling, and GMS. And so let me not talk too much about the three methods. Just let me mention that PA test, all it does is it takes a stand on which of the moment inequalities are binding. And he says, I'm going to consider that all the moment inequalities are binding. Okay. The moment equalities have to be binding, the model is correctly specified, so he's going to assume that. But he's also going to assume that all the moment inequalities are binding. And by that, he constructs a conservative test. Okay, so this is going to be a very problematic feature of the PA test versus its competitors over here. So in the subsampling test or the GMS test, you use the data in one way or another to detect which of the moment conditions are binding and which are not. So you actually use the data to instead of taking a stand. And the difference with subsampling is, the difference with PA is that both of these guys are going to be size correct, meaning that if you want to reject some probability of 5%, you're actually going to get 5%, whereas the rejection rate in PA could be much, much lower than 5%, even under correct specification. So here I have a little lemma basically describing the three values of the asymptotic size, so I'm going to skip this very fast. Let me keep for sake of time. If you actually use these formulas over here to compare the asymptotic size, what we're going to find out is that, so remember the asymptotic size is what we're looking for here in order to compare test, and high means bad. We're going to notice that if you want 5% rejection rate, if you have local misspecification, all of them are going to be over rejecting as expected. Okay. Plugin asymptotics is the one that is going to over-reject the least. Okay? And out of the other two, we cannot compare. Actually, we can compare and we can say they are equal. So they have exactly the same rejection rate under the none. Okay? So, so again, all of them are over 5% and that's unavoidable. And so let me comment. This is basically our main result regarding the ranking. So if you want a ranking over here regarding plug-in asymptotic subsampling and GNS. And again, this is for a fixed test statistic here. We're doing this for either if you're doing modified method moments or you're doing quasi-logic regression, you get exactly the same ranking. The champion in terms of robustness is going to be plug-in asymptotics. And in second place, you have subsampling and GNS in a tie. Okay? So, first comment, PA is expected to be robust. This is not very surprising. And notice that, and the reason for this is, it takes a conservative stand. So, if you want 5% rejection rate, if you are under the NAC, correct specification, you're going to under-reject. Okay? So there's no surprise that when you introduce misspecification, this level is going to raise, but by a much lower amount than the other two guys, subsampling and GNS. And actually, in my opinion, from this race, we should disqualify plug-in asymptotics because he's already starting from a level that is below alpha. Okay? So there's really no surprise that he's going to be more robust. And the result that we find really remarkable here is that asymptotic size of GNS is equal to asymptotic size of subsampling. And so the reason why this is remarkable for us is that if you look at Andos and Suarez, and they compare these two methods, what they find is that GNS is strictly more powerful than subsampling under certain sequences. So if you expect the trade-off between power and robustness to hold, we should expect asymptotic size to be less, GNS to be less robust than subsampling. And we are observing that they have the same level of robustness. Okay, and the intuition comes from we're finding the worst sequence. Okay, and that's really the bottom line of our result. So there are some sequences for which, under misspecification, GNS is going to reject more frequently than subsampling. And there are some other sequences for which subsampling and GNS are going to reject at the same rate. And when we do the analysis, the worst sequence, which is the one that we're really interested in when you compute asymptotic size, is going to be a sequence of the second type. And that explains why they're equal in terms of robustness. And for sake of time, here we're commenting on the assumptions. Let me just assure you that the assumptions are not strong. We verify them on all our examples. All the interpretation of the assumptions, essentially the key assumption is that the underlying economic model is sufficiently rich in terms of what can happen. And if you find, so in the examples that we try, we find that the models that we're considering are sufficiently rich. So the recommendation in terms of comparing the columns is that if you're only worried about robustness, if that's all you're worried about, then really what you should check and what you should use is plug-in asymptotics. But we say that this is artificially fueled by the fact that PA is conservative to start with. So we really, in my opinion, PA is disqualified. And in the second place, subsampling and GMS are equally robust, so if you worry about robustness, we don't have any recommendation. You can pick whatever you want. But if you take the analysis of Anderson Suarez, you should see that GMS is better in terms of power. They are equal in terms of robustness, so you can freely choose GMS and enjoy your higher power without sacrificing any robustness. So we think it's a very positive result for GMS. Okay, so now let me move to the analysis of robustness in terms of the test statistics. So now again, for this part of the presentation, I'm going to fix the column, and I'm going to compare the rows. Okay? And there are two very popular choices for test statistics. So remember that the function S, which is used to construct the test statistic, well, the choice of the test statistic is basically choosing different function S. So there's an S1 function that is called modified method moments, and there's an S2 function that is called quasi-logic regression. So these have to be criterion functions in the sense that if you plug in, so here we're giving a space for the expectation, and here we're giving the expectation of M, and here we're giving a space for the variance of M. And we have to plug in these two parameters over here. And if they are a true criterion function, when you plug in the expectation of M here and the variance here, you should expect, and if the model is correctly specified, you should expect a value of 0 here. And if you are in the, if you are outside the identified set, when you plug in the expectation and the variance, you should observe a number that is positive. That's the role of a criterion function. So let me check very quickly that S1 is a criterion function. So if I plug, so I have P moment inequalities, so in the moment inequalities, the expectation of M has to be positive or 0, if I plug something that is positive or zero, I divide it by standard deviation, it's still going to be positive or zero. Negative part is zero, take squares, you get a zero. Sum, you get zeros. Here you have k minus p moment equality, plugging the moment equality, which should be zero, if you are under the identified set, divide by a positive number, you still get a zero. Square, sum, you get zeros. Whenever you are outside the identified set, you should see that either of this or that is going to give you a positive number. So that works as a Hermitian function. And I can do the same analysis for S2. So again, throughout this section, I'm going to keep the column constant. And I'm going to compare asymptotic size of my finite moments and quasi-latitude ratio. Here, a little bit of notation that is basically unavoidable. In our setup, where you have all the conditions that define a script F, there is the restriction that the variance, the space of correlation matrices of the model have to belong to this psi, I think. So we have to, depending on what is your economic model, you have to figure out what this is. So let us take this psi to be the space of correlation matrices that are determinant, that have a determinant greater or equal than epsilon, for some epsilon greater or equal than zero. Okay, so the point here is that when you're going to compare these two functions, you have to be aware that the comparison is not that fair because modified method moments can admit any type of correlation matrix. Okay, so So here I'm dividing by standard deviation. Okay, provided you're using a correlation matrix, standard deviation is equal to 1, but you're not using anything outside the main diagonal. So there's, even if the correlation matrix is singular, this guy is not going to have any problems. However, if you use a quasi-latitude ratio and you plug in a correlation matrix that is non-singular, you're going to run into problems here when you try to invert. So really, you cannot compare these two guys in the same, with the same kind of matrix. So the point is, modified method moments needs to can assume any correlation matrix. Quasi-latitude ratio needs some, to avoid non-singularities, needs some, the determinant to be greater than zero. Okay, so with that caveat, here's the main theorem that compares asymptotic size of modified method moments and quasi-latitude ratio, and the theorem says, assume certain assumptions, and let me assume that the space of correlation matrix is equal to the space of all correlation matrices with determinant greater or equal than epsilon. Okay. And the theorem says that for any epsilon, okay, even epsilon equal to zero, there is going to be some constant, okay, which depends on only the number of moment inequalities plus the moment inequalities that you have, such that the asymptotic size of modified method moments has an upper bound of bk, and bk we can prove that is strictly less than 1. Okay, so in terms of distortion, when you introduce misspecification, this guy can grow. But we know that no matter what the space of correlation matrix is, the maximum value that the asymptotic size can take is b sub k. Meaning that the asymptotic size distortion, the maximum asymptotic size distortion can be bk minus alpha. On the other hand, give me any eta that you want. Okay? So remember here the problem is I cannot, for quasi-latitude ratio, I cannot take epsilon equal to 0 as I did here. But give me any eta that you want. And I can find you an epsilon bar that is positive, such that if epsilon is allowed to be between 0 and epsilon bar, the asymptotic size of QLR is above 1 minus eta. Okay? So in particular, this is saying that, of course, we cannot take eta equal to 0 because this problem is blows up, but I can always make the eta sufficiently close to 0 so that the asymptotic size is going to grow, essentially without any problem of reaching 1. So this theorem is already giving you a comparison between asymptotic size of modified method moments and asymptotic size of QLR. It's telling you that for a sufficiently rich space of finite covariance matrices, the asymptotic size of quasi-latitude ratio is strictly greater than asymptotic size of modified method moments, and both of them are greater than alpha. Okay, so in terms of the comparison, okay, if this is a metric for which we evaluate robustness, quasi-latitude ratio is less robust than modified method moment. So in terms of who is first and who is second, this guy is first, this guy is second, regardless of which method of approximation of the critical value is something. It doesn't matter. You get this one. Okay, and this result, we think that it's not surprising. Okay, we expected this because of the trade-off between power and robustness. However, what we didn't expect and we find really interesting here is that the amount of distortion that you can have with quasi-dynamic configuration is essentially unbounded. You can get arbitrarily close to one. Okay? So not in qualitative terms, but in quantitative terms, the amount of distortion of quasi-dynamic configuration is essentially as high as you possibly can. Okay? So as I said, if you look at the paper by Anderson here, they do some simulations in order to compare the power of quasi-dynamical ratio and modified method moments, and they find that quasi-dynamical ratio is more powerful than modified method moments. Consequently, we expected quasi-dynamical ratio to be less robust than modified method moments. However, what we did not expect is the amount of distortion that you could achieve with quasi-dynamical ratio, which is essentially as high as you can. So the intuition that we have is that quasi-likelihood, or basically intuition for the proof, is that quasi-likelihood ratio, if you look at the formula, is using all the information in the variance-covariance matrix, whereas this guy is only using the diagonal, okay? Which means that if that non-diagonal terms contain information as to if you're trying to distinguish null hypothesis from an impostor, if that non-diagonal terms contain information as to that relationship, when you're doing local alternative analysis, the ability to use non-diagonal terms in order to detect null alternatives is a blessing. For us, it's actually a curse, because you are observing something that really belongs to another, but from your perspective, it's an alternative. But, so we say that because of the trade-off, that's not very surprising. What's really surprising is that the amount of non-robustness to that. By the way, we actually know this number. Okay, it's not that it's just a fixed number. We can actually give you this number for everything. So the recommendation in terms of the rows is that if you're only worried about robustness to local specification, which is what we're doing today, the best method is undoubtedly modified method moments. If you care about both robustness and power, then there is a trade-off, and you have to choose which one do you care more. You care more about power, or more about robustness. If you only care about power, you should choose QLR. If you care about both, then you have to think. It's not obvious. All we're doing here is just warning you that if you choose QLR just because of power reasons, we are warning that if you are a little bit misspecified, the amount of distortion that you can create with QLR is essentially as high as you can. As high as you can. But there's a very high cost of choosing QLR for power reasons in terms of robustness. So I'm ready to conclude. So what this paper does is it runs inferential methods in partially identified models, moment inequality and inequality models in terms of the size of the size distortion under local specification. And I didn't cover this, but our results extend if you're interested in confidence sets by inversion. So what is local classification? You are considering a hypothesis test where elements of the null hypothesis from the correctly specified model, from your perspective, which is an incorrectly specified model, are looking at like the alternative hypothesis. So you're going to have a tendency to over-reject. Okay? So there's no surprise that asymptotic size is greater than alpha, and there is a distortion, and all we do is run the test in terms of the size distortion. And we were happy to provide a ranking over here among all choices. So if you have to choose, in principle we didn't know whether the comparison of columns and rows depending on each other, but it turns out that it doesn't. The best one over here is PA. These two are equal in second place. I argue already that PA should be disqualified because it's starting already in a correctly specified model with a level of distortion, level of rejection that is relatively low, so we discard this guy. So we say, well, okay, out of these two guys, we are indifferent, no recommendation, they are equally good or bad, which means that you should choose based on any other criterion, for example, power, which is going to tell that maybe you should choose GMS. And out of these two models, in terms of robustness, we're going to say that this is first, and this is in second place, but this is in a very far second place. So the amount of distortions here is arbitrarily close to 1. So we're going to recommend modified measure moments just based on robustness. If you care about both robustness and power, then it's up to you what you care more. But we're warning you that choosing QLR just for power reasons could be dangerous in terms of robustness. Okay, so there is some future work that we're kind of doing, I think. So we only consider 2 test statistics, and we're planning on considering some more. And the other thing that we need to do is to perform simulations, and it's actually very important. So usually, the reason to do simulations when you're doing asymptotic analysis is because you want to know whether your asymptotic analysis, which is only true as n plus infinity, is actually makes any sense for a finite n. Okay? We're doing asymptotic analysis, so we're worried about that too. But we are interested also in performing simulations for a second very important reason, is that we are approaching the problem of misspecification from a local perspective, meaning that the amount of misspecification converges to 0. So we say that this is suitable for a situation where the misspecification is small. So there's a second approximation there. So what we really need to do in order to perform simulations, and I said that we are advancing this already, is to take a situation with a finite n and a small amount of misspecification and see whether our results in terms of the ranking actually hold when you're doing finite sample analysis.